All right. Good evening, everyone. Wait, I don't need this. Welcome to a live stream of a RPG developer, Bakin, somewhat tutorial as well. I'm going to go over the event panel. So let's go ahead and get started there. It's just my mini map. I'll just use this one. That's fine. All right. Going down the list. Starting with conversation. Here is where you will have conversations between different casts. You have different import options right here. Import support. You have bold, italic, underline, font size, font color, ruby. Ruby for specific strings. We have half a second wait, specified seconds wait. You can put how long you want to wait in the seconds braces. Instant display start end, instant display end, waiting for input. So that's like it's waiting for you to continue along. Close automatically. It'll close without anything that needs to be done. You can display the value of a variable. You can display the value of an array variable. So you'll display the variable name and the index in that variable. You can display the value of a local variable. You can display the cast name. You can blink, change the blink speed. You can change the blink rate. You can have lip sync speech, which I have not played with, but I will maybe one day. Name bots, it'll appear above the message box, the name bot center, it'll go into the center and the right. So here we'll just make a little hello person. So you'll click it and then it'll actually have you. You're able to type it in yourself. Cast one to be displayed. You can pick a person to talk. So you can click that, and then from here you can choose an animation, whatever you would want, to have them doing while they're talking. Same for the cast too. You can choose who is talking at the time of the conversation. So if you wanted to have multiple conversations, you would split this up. You can flip it horizontal. That's more for like 2D images. Window display position is top, center, and bottom. Speech bubble would be like kind of like a thought bubble above them. Use maps light source, which would be the light source for the cast being displayed. So display message is kind of the same thing, except you don't have any cast options. You can do all the same input supports here. You can hide the window as well, which will make it transparent. Same options, top, center, bottom, and speech bubble. Ticker text is like kind of like a Star Wars type text. You still have most of the same input supports here. And if you wanted to make it scroll like Star Wars style-ish, make sure you check the make ticker scroll. You can even have an image. For the background, you do none, black, or an image for your background. Display effect. This is how we show particle effects. You can display on the event, the player, display in center of the screen, or an image. This is actually a really cool feature with the image because you can... Let's see. Well, not for particle, but for sprites and such. You can make... you can move sprites and stuff very easily with this. But I'll get into that in a second. So you select your effect. You can do particles, sprites, layout. This is just the basic set that comes with Bakin. Emotion. This is kind of the same thing as the... what is it? An effect on the event, but you can choose sprites or you can choose the emotions. You can actually put any sprite you really want. And you can have the wait to complete, which means it'll wait until the animation's done and then it'll go on to the next part. This I won't probably ever play with because it's kind of you have to be good with mapping and everything for like the texture. You could probably fiddle with it, but you have to make your own textures and everything. You have all kinds of different options. It's actually a really cool feature, but like I said, I'm not good with UV mapping and all that. Onto screen effects, display image. This is how you would display an image on screen. Let's say you wanted to display a custom type slider that Bakin can't do in the layout tool. Like if you wanted to do like a wedge kind of system, you would use this. You would make an image. I don't have any really set up here. This is all kind of using the Bakin's things. I'm just kind of explaining how you can use it. The position here is you can specify specifically where to use. Let me get an image because it's going to be a pain without one. Sure, why not? So we'll use this. And actually, oh, that's right. So this is actually cool too. So if you have the images sliced up in the images, you can use this to go through the slices and place it in your own, or make your own, because it's taking the section of each slice, and that's what the pattern is. So you can even use a variable for that too, which is actually kind of cool. I gotta play with that some more. Display position is actually a really cool feature too. You can have, I'll show you, you can have like the variables of the event or players on the screen. You can use that and you can put that in here as well. You can specify it specifically. You can change the magnification ratio. You can actually rotate it too. You can fade it in and make it translucent. So let's see. Display string as image number. This is how you would place like a time system if you didn't want to use the layout tool, which I would probably prefer to use this anyways, because you can have a little bit better control over. You have all the same inputs as like a message. So you can do like display, variable. You can do like variable and it'll show your variable on screen. You can change the color. You can even use color tags in between each little section in here and it'll color it. Just make sure you set it to white or the color you're using for your text. You can use the outline, you can use a shadow. You can have it center aligned, left aligned, or right aligned. You can also specify the position as well. You can use the variables as well, just like the image. This is how you can do damage numbers and such for, like, say, an action battle system. So you can move the image. This image control number is referring to the image you use or variable you're using for the image you're trying to move. You can use a variable or a number. You can change the position after. You can change all of it. And you have time to move and such. And such, you can also have a wait to complete function as well. Delete the image. This is when you have a number pop up or something and you wanted to fade it out or delete it instantly. You would use this, or if you needed to delete an image off the screen, you would use this as well. Brighten, darken screen. You can brighten the screen and a set amount of time. You can even use a variable, which you could fiddle some delta time into it to make it super, super smooth. Darken, same thing. It'll brighten or darken the screen. Let me see this real quick. I'm not 100% sure how this one works. Okay, so yeah. So completely, it's like a fade out. And the other one's like a fade in, or like a white in. You can change the screen color. You select the color you want here, or you can put in an RGBA. You can actually use Nightfish's little tool. That's a great little tool to get a color you would need. Set the opacity. 255 is completely visible. 0 is transparent. Wait in time. You can shake the screen as well. Weak, middle, strong. And the time can be a variable as well as decimals. And you can have a wait to complete as well. Hit D. Why are you not deleting it? All right. you can flash the screen as well, which I'll show you real quick. You can even have that in like a loop to keep it going nonstop. That would work as well. Let's go ahead and delete that. Display save screen varies, self-explanatory. There's no options for it, so you're just going to hit that. If you wanted to show your save screen, you would hit this, and that would display your save screen. Display item selection screen. So this is, if you have multiple item selection screens, you would click this before you would want to open that item selection, because it's going to tell Bakin which layout to be used. Free layout for event. This is a fantastic feature for Bakin. This lets us control the layout tool. Very, very important to note, especially when you're running the layouts and then a loop or a repeating types event script and everything. You want to always make sure your first one is display and the rest has to be add and display, or it won't show. It'll try to just keep showing the one and not the last one. It'll show the last one and not the first one. So display is showing it. And personally, I wouldn't put display or layouts into a loop because it does get really, really finicky. Display, add and display. This is just adding and displaying onto here. You can hide them all, or you can hide select ones. So like, you don't have your drop buttons, and this will be all your tool or your layouts that you have in your system that you can hide personally. Display title screen. It's not going to give us any options. It's just going to show the title screen. Same for the main menu screen. There's no configurable options. You're just going to click that when you want to show the main menu screen. This is actually cool. This is relatively new too. So the layout type is going to be, I'll show you in the layout tool. So this is going to let you select which layout type you want to use. So let's say maps, if you had a different config, you would use that. Map. What's that? Let's do, I don't have any other options. But if you have multiple layouts in the layout section, you can change this automatically. Or automagically, as some people say. Where was it? This is kind of like the same thing, but it's letting you change most of the system type things. If you had different type messages, you would select this and then you would make the add that. This is if you wanted to have like different kind of like message windows and such, like different colors or like layouts and whatnot. Specify game over. Super simple. Whenever your variables or your cast HP, well, really the player's HP just down to like 0 or whatnot, or whenever you want the game over, this will give you your options if you want to go back to title, revive right on the spot, or you can do advanced settings. In the edit settings, you can have them go to a certain map, or you can even have, you can have them go to like a separate map or like the start of the map. So like if they died like over here, you can make them move to like the very start of the map and then go from there. You can, you can revive people, or you can just revive the player. You can give them 1 HP, or you can specify a value. Same for their MP. You can actually even load a common event after they've been moved to their spot. So that's actually really nifty too. I think that's relatively new as well. One second. Okay. Display web browser. So if you were to put in, let's do this. Where's the Bakin? RPG. So let's say I wanted to hear, we'll do this. This is going to be the namespace for, so when you test play, it'll pop up in a new browser window. It didn't show over here, it's on my other monitor, but it'll pop up a browser. Like, I don't know how this is actually, kind of useful. I mean, I guess people can use it to like, for a help section or whatnot, but you can use that. Delete that. And hello, head-ons. Welcome. Play movie, you can only display .wbms, I do believe, still. Let me see. Yeah, I don't think I can. Let's see. Okay, so ESRBRs, which would be like an import, or a web .webbm, which I don't have any. It's very choppy, so I wouldn't really use it personally just yet. You can change your render settings, which is actually really cool. Like, you could have a all kinds of different changes. Like, if you say like you're low on health or something, you can do like a monotone, like you're losing all color in your life. All kinds of fun stuff you can do with the render settings. All right, cameras. Camera playback. So this lets you choose which camera you want to play. You can even have a wait to complete. This would be useful for, say, you have a cutscene or whatnot. You can make a custom camera and just have it play that, and it can go through its motions. Then you can wait to complete it. There's all kinds of things you can do with the camera. So this controls your camera operations. So you have your camera angle and zoom operations. You can enable and disable it. You can change, horizontal rotation, vertical rotation, and zoom. These are all configured in your game definitions over here. So if you don't even have the camera zoom and all that, you really don't have to worry about that. But this is where, these are all the buttons and such for your configuration for the camera and everything. Back to here. Delete you. Enable disable battle camera. This is when you are in battle. So, excuse me. So if you wanted to not even really have a custom camera or everything, you would just disable all this. So the chat, anything that's checked will be enabled. So if you don't want results, you don't want to use all this, you can disable that, which is kind of nice. Change camera parameters. This is actually relatively new, which is actually really cool. You can make, like while you're waiting for a turn, you can have it rotate around your player and everything. You, you would want to make a, use it from a variable and use like a delta time type variable to make it function better. All right, teleport player. Specify orientation. This is if you wanted to keep the same orientation, or you wanted to like warp into a different room where they're facing a different way, you would change it here. You can specify a map. You can actually specify it with variables as well for this map, or an ID. Oh, that's right. So this is actually, this is pretty much, I think, the last update. So this is actually really cool. You can set a variable. Each map can have its own variable ID now. So you can warp to different maps with this. Change player orientation. This is how you change the way they are facing. You can face them in a random direction. You can spin them around. You can face this specified angle. You can click here. You can have it any way you really want. You can have it face towards this event. This is useful for when, like, say you're talking to an NPC or whatnot, or if you're like in a battle system or something. You can make them face the opposite of this event. This event would be referring to an event that is not a common event. It will not work if you are trying to use this in a common event. So just keep that in mind. Forfeits direction is... Right, come on. Come on, tooltip. So this kind of like forces it to, if you're trying to do just up, down, left, right. Northeast, southeast, southwest, it'll kind of make it, kind of force it to just be up, down, left, right, or north, south, east, west. All right, make player walk. This is a fun little feature. I wouldn't technically really use it much for the player. I would be using a different, I'll show you. You can have them walk in the direction they're facing. So like if you wanted to have them walk one step in the direction they're facing, you would click this. And then you would change their number of steps right there. You can walk to a specified angle. There's all kinds of things you can do with that. You can make it walk towards this event. Like I said, this event is referring to an actual event made either on the map or the task database. It cannot be a common event. You can have them walk in a random direction. Same thing here, forfeits directions. It'll force it to go up, down, left, right, or north, south, east, west. I don't know why I keep saying that. So, like I said, we have all the north, south, east, west here, so you can pick that. Number of steps, like I said, you can do that, and you can also do a variable. So if you actually wanted it to do below 0.01, which you kind of could, I guess, you can make it a variable. You can lock their orientation so that they kind of slide in place. You can make them pass through other events. You can make them ignore elevation. So like if there's a say there's a terrain there and there's a higher terrain there, if you move them, it's just gonna go straight up there. This is pretty much always ticked because you kind of want it. This kind of makes it so they don't occupy the space of another event or a obstacle or a object. Keep current motion. This is great for animation. So like if you wanted to have like a moving attack, you would make sure that this is checked so you can keep the motion going. Change orientation smoothly. This is actually a cool little feature. It kind of makes it so they kind of like do an arc when they change orientation. Let me make a quick one real quick. I'll show you. I really should have made examples, but you know, this is kind of like thrown together real quick. Alright, so event walk towards player, and we'll make a change orientation. Okay. We'll give you something. Sure, why not? I don't care. Just a little model that I was playing with. So like you'll see when you do that, like it kind of curves a little bit. That's actually kind of funny. Oh, so that, look, he's kind of orbiting. All right. You know, that's actually kind of interesting. All right, so back to this. Player. Now, I won't go over the events because, or won't be going all over the events and stuff, because the same thing except for events. I'll go over, obviously, event-specific things. You can change their player movement speeds. This is actually really... good for whenever you need to make a player move really quick in one spot or like a couple steps and then change their speed back. So you would change it first make them walk, and then change it back to normal or whatever their speed is. Make player invisible, invisible. This is super self-explanatory. Makes them invisible or visible. Change cast graphic. This is good for like when you are making a create a character kind of thing. Also, this is good for 2D stamps because there's not that many emotions. Oh, excuse me. Also, this is where if you wanted to change their graphic for the layout at the time or their icon at the time, you can actually change it to the nth in the party. So whoever's in the party, you can change it based on that value. You would change the cast to be changed is right here. You would click that and then you would select the cast you would want to be changed. Where is it? Change cast motion. This is for animations. If you wanted to have like a button press or something, you would ignore all these names. I have not named them. So let's say run. Sure. You wanted to run, you can make it run. It'll run the entire animation unless you move. So if you wanted to break that, you should play the whole animation and it'll move. Just make sure if you're doing it with movement, you have it keep the current animation so that way it all runs smoothly. Change player Y corner. This is a fun little feature. You can specify from the current value. So if they're at zero and you change it from zero, it's not going to move, obviously. This is great for if you want to suspend a player in the air because that will keep it right where you need to be. You can specify the absolute value as well. So like if you wanted it to be at exactly like three, it would go straight to three. And if you wanted to specify from the current value, it would go from wherever it's at to three. You can change the time. The movement speed, moving speed is constant, acceleration, deceleration. So it'll go constantly. Acceleration, it goes super fast and it goes slow. And then deceleration, it goes super slow then fast. You can wait until the Y coordinate change has completed. Also, you can check deletion contention. I would always probably have this on because this is fantastic. Because like, if you're too high up or too low, you're not gonna collide with anything, so it's perfect. Oh, excuse me. Start player falling. This is a great little feature too. This is when, say, when you're moving with physics, or if you're actually using the change Y, right after that, you can use the start player falling. The higher it is, the harder you fall. So the lower it is, the slower you fall. You can actually even have a wait for the fall to complete as well. Player traversable terrain. So this is like saying if you wanted to have them walk on water, you would enable it here. Change player scale. There's no X, Y, or Z to change, so it's just going to change it to a percentage, I think it is. And then there's the time and everything. You can wait till scale change completes as well. Attach model to cast. Now this is an awesome feature. So if you make your model have left and right hooks, you can have it to where you can automatically make each hand have a different weapon. Let me see if there's... No, I don't have anything. Well, here, let me see real quick. Two small game builder pack. We'll do an axe real quick. Okay, so an axe. It's not showing up because it's not... I don't think I have hooks on this character. Okay. Well, generally, well, you know, here, let me load a character real quick that has item hooks. I know I have one, so just bear with me real quick. All right, I'll load him in real quick. All right. So you see how it's in his hand? That's because I have item hoods that I made in Blender, or you add in Blender. I do have a tutorial on that as well. But you can automatically have them have items in their hand with this. You can even put people. Look, I can even put... gotta do the right hand. Where is he? Yeah, so you can even put people on the hand. So, I mean, that's just ridiculous. Enable disable player orientation change. This is if you want to make it so they cannot change which direction they're facing, or if you need them to not move at all, really. Make player invincible. This is good for like action games or whatnot, or let's say you have a poison type thing. You don't want them to keep getting constantly poisoned or whatnot. You can use this to make them invincible. They won't get any touch damage and they won't lose any of their parameters. Ooh. All right. Snap player on grid. This is actually a really cool feature as well. So a grid in Bakin, if it's not in the middle, it's not exact. If it's out of it, it's like 0.5. So this is great when you want to have exact grid movement. You would use snap player on grid. Make player watch tooth. This is great. This is actually more used for event and everything, but you can use this for cutscenes as well. This is great for cutscenes. So you can use this. You can have them move to like right here or whatnot, or like any specific place. Or even an X or Z value. Have them face specified angles. Interpolation, same as before. So I want to say acceleration or constant acceleration, deceleration, accelerate to decelerate. Curve movement, like I said, it makes it, where it curves and everything. I mean, it's very self-explanatory. Keep current motion is just like normal walking. Change cast equipment. This is for when you wanted to, when you need to equip your cast with a different item. So you have weapon, arm, armor, headgear, body armor, accessory 1 and 2. So if you wanted to swap armors and everything, you would be using this function. Change cast class, very self-explanatory. You can change their the cast, the person in the party. Change target, what's this? Oh, so this change clicks the class you want to change it to. So you can do the class, or you can even do the subclass. You don't even have to do the class. You can transfer their state or their experience over if you want to. I don't know why you can't do that. I guess because it's not a subclass. Rotate player. Very simple. Absolute value you can use, which would be not relative to the player. It would be the exact value. So you'd want to try to use relative value from the current orientation. XYZ. I don't have the best examples off the top of my head. But it's the XYZ plus 360. So like 360 on the X or negative 360 on the X. Same for the Y and Z. Move player with physics engine. This is a great feature. So you can make them move on the X axis, the Y, and the Z. So the X would be left and right. Y would be the height. So if you need to go below, you do negative. Higher, you would add on to it. Z is up and down, but not height. It's more like the, of the grid. It's not the height. So Y is the height, Z is the up and down. No, we don't need that. And you can set that as a variable too, so you can have all kinds of fun little calculations with it. Party, there's not many functions to do with a party. You can add or move the party member. This You can carry over their statuses, add to the reserve, add same name cast as new individual. Add same name. Okay. I don't really use the default system, so this is all kind of Greek to me almost. Rename party member. This is how you would name your party members. You can change the cast. You can change the nth in party. You would set it all up here. You can have... that's cool. So here's the... what is it? Whenever you want to make your own custom one, here's all the... use the help section. This is the match number of letters that can be entered. And this is where you would do like top, center, or bottom for the where you would want the name change to go. So like here, I'll show you real quick. So if I wanted to change the hero's name to G. So now his name is G. So you can make that all custom and everything. Delete that. Add casts to the party trains, rearrange the order. Oh, okay. That's right. Excuse me, I had to sneeze. So with this... ooh. We can change the train. So if you show the players on screen or when you're walking, this is the train. So you can change the order however you would like. Statuses. Here you can increase and decrease the items. So whatever item you have in your item database, you can use that here to increase and decrease. You can even use a variable. Which has a lot of control with that, but you can also use a value as well. Discard item. This makes it so like this option is not, you can't cancel it. And then you can turn on, switch on when canceled. Okay, that's cool. So this lets you make a switch saying that it's gone or whatnot, or like saying, hey, look, this is gone. You can't ever get it back. So change. Item enhancement. This is all brand new, so I'm not 100% sure how this one works. I'll try my best, but I'm assuming it's the nth in the inventory would be the item in the inventory database. You can change. Oh, wow. The basic settings, the weapon equipment settings, consumable settings. Oh, wow. Okay. So, yeah. So, the element you can change is the level of the price. You can change their attribute power, critical rate, match damage, recovery amount, consumable settings, all this. And changes an ability. Oh, wow. See, that's cool. Change item name. Oh, wow. See, I don't use the default system too much, so this is all relatively new to me. Kind of like the same, yeah, change the item name is int in the inventory. You can use a variable or a value. You can use input supports down here for the string. You can do a string before the original name, and you can do a string after the original name. That's kind of cool. Or if you didn't want to use the original name, you can click that as well. Huh. Increase, decrease money, very self-explanatory. You have your whatever value or whatever type of money you use, you would increase or decrease here with a value or a decimal. Recover, reduce HP or MP right here. So you can do the entire party, or you can select a certain cast. Ends in the party as well. You can do either HP or MP. You can increase or decrease and with a variable or a value. Fully recover party, no options. You just click it and it'll fully recover your party. You can increase and decrease the experience. This is all a flat value right now. There's no actual experience table, so this is all very flat, simple. You can get X amount of XP, decrease it, increase it. Learn, forget skill. You can learn your skills here. Or you can forget them. So like if you wanted to like say you can't have this, but you can have this, this would be great to set up like your classes and whatnot. You can do Anthem Party or the cast to be changed or the entire party. You can increase and decrease their this should say the stats value. Ability value is fine. It makes sense. You can choose the cast to be changed, the entire party, or you can do Nth in the party. You can change their max HP, MP, attack power, magical power, defense power, and agility. We're gonna do that. This is how you would set up status effects. Like if you wanted to give them poison and whatnot, you can change the entire party or just certain cast. Nth in the party, and this would be you give it to the. This would make it give it to the cast, and this would take it away. Events, I'm not going to go over it. The only thing that is different would be. I forgot subgraphics. So the same for player. This is for your subgraphics section. You can change the number to be changed, or you can use a variable as well. So you can like make a button that changes it and whatnot, or like source a variable that changes that. You can make it visible or hide it, and the time to change. Make event as operation target. This is great for cutscenes. So what this function does is, if you are in one event and you need to take control of another event, you would use this function. So in this event, event one's the only one I have, because that's the only one I have on screen, but it'll have the list of all the ones you have on this current map that you have behind me. So you can target that, and once you make that a target, anything that says this event will be for this. So sounds. Very self-explanatory, play background music, adjust volume, you can adjust the tempo, fade out, fade in. Same for environmental sounds, you can click environmental sounds like bugs or crickets chirping. Play sound effect for like an attack or button and whatnot, you would select your sound, volume, tempo, and play. Playing this 3D sound is only good when you want it to be spatial. Play fanfare. This is cool for when you want to do like victory fanfare or whatnot. No, that's volume, tempo, and everything. Variable boxes. I'm not gonna go too heavy in this, because this would take me like all night. So variable box number, you can change the variable here, and you can change the values from there or to a variable. And you can overwrite add a random number, zero to value. So it'd be zero to whatever value is here. You can add it, multiply it, subtract, and divide. Advanced variable box operation. Majority of the time, this is where all my variable operations go. You can pick your variable here. You can do fits value, random number, variable box, money, possession, money of number of items possessed, cast status, inf status in the party, event status. This is grabbing the information from the database for a cast-based event. Current time, play time, map XZ. Map Z size, or map X and Z size, map ID, that's the new one now. So we can make that a variable, and we can grab that for teleporting and whatnot. Operation key are buttons. Camera settings are very self-explanatory. Coordinate information for this event, which would be the X, Y, Z. X coordinates on the screen, Y coordinates on the screen, X rotation, Y coordinate, rotation, orientation, Z rotation, and the orientation of the four directions. So up, down, left, right. Same for the player, all the same. Current party number, this is how you would get the party numbers information. Mouse information, you can get mouse X, Y, left click, right click, center wheel, and wheel rotation. This is how you would have button clicks and everything with a mouse. Arithmetic functions, I'm not even going to try. You can do sin, cos, tan, 2. Absolute, this is if you wanted to have an absolute number, you can do the square root, you can do pi, you can do rad to dead, and dead to rad. I thought I was going to get away from it from high school, but I guess not. Back to this. Excuse me. So elapsed time from previous, frame, this is delta time. This is going to be the time it took from the last frame to the current frame, which you can set as a variable. Player operation locked state. This checks to see if the player is locked or unlocked. So, like, say you need to stop the player moving and all the other, you can set a variable to check that. This is the nth parameter in the inventory, which is brand new, so I don't know anything about. Parameter for item, for item base only. Assigned to string variables. Strings are very, very cool, and you should be using them. So with the string variable number, you can make it, like, say, moving. I can make that move, and it'll override it. It can add to the beginning or it can add to the end. Like, say if you wanted to have multiple things in the string, you can add to beginning or add to end. Input string variables. This is for if you need to have change, like, a string variable, and like you want to input it yourself. You can do that here. So, like, if you wanted to store a name or whatnot, you would use this. String variable operation, another great feature. You have the options to pick your variable, then you can do string variable bots, current map name, cast status, end status in the party, this event's name. Oh, that's cool. Name of shooting source, that's for generating an event. Nth parameter in the inventory, like I said, these two are brand new, so I don't know much about. String replacement, this is changing this from A with B. So, like, if you need to swap strings around and whatnot, you would use this function. Attain terrain information. This is great for when you want to check, like, a enemy area that you want to be able to, like, trigger a battle or something, or like even have different sounds or different effects. You can use this. You can grab the name of the terrain and everything, and then you can check from there. You can even check the elevation. Oh, that's cool. I didn't know you could check the elevation. Switches, very simple. Turn it on and off. Enable player separation. Enable or disable. You can't move. Player to run. This turns off running altogether. I don't know why I couldn't think of that. So you enable it, disable it. Party train, if you didn't want to have a party train or you wanted to switch on and off, you can use that. Enable, disable monster appearing. If you don't want monsters to appear, you would use this. Like if you wanted to have like a repel or something, you would use this. And whenever you would turn that on. This is if you have your custom menu screen, you can turn it on or disable it. You can also turn it off, I think, in the game definitions as well. You can enable disable saves here. You can enable disable the built-in jumps here. You can enable disable moving. That's with the directional pads, keypads, and everything. Change operation mode, basic operation, or tank controls. You can change all that on the fly. Conditional judgment. All right. So, conditional judgments are huge. There's all kinds of things you can do with conditional judgments. For this, you can select from selection. This is like if you want to say, oh, do I look pretty? You can say yes or no, whatnot. And then you would pick the options and whatnot. Execute battle and check results. This is how you would make your own custom battles. You can have different options. You can have different placements. change the background music. It can be inescapable if you don't want them running. You can even make it so they don't game over even if defeated. And then no monster appearance message. Display store and check results. Oh. Okay, so this is how you set up your store. I haven't really made one yet, so I don't know. Okay. Oh, that's really simple. Wow, they simplified that. So you can have the default layout screen, which does the store and everything, or you can have your own. You can have a display. You can change the buy screen. You can change the sell screen if you want to have selling. Well, I'm gonna have to look into that. That's actually kind of cool. I'm assuming this is the same for the end. Yeah. So the end is just charges you the amount and then position, selection position. I guess this is whatever you want it. Cheer state. You can cheer states from this and you can recover from KOs from other party members. Check event switch. This checks to see if a switch is on or off. Check variable. Same thing. Kind of. So you can check a variable to a value or a variable to a variable. You can do equals, not equal to, greater than or equal to, less than or less than or equal to. Where was I? All right. Oh, same for variable bots. You can kind of change your variable or string variables here. You can, so let's say if you wanted to make sure, see if an event is colliding with certain name, you can do like, say, I don't know, that is equal to enemy or whatnot. It can be the same, or you can even make it include to where if enemy is in the name, it'll still check it. But if you want it to be exact, you can use, same. With include, you can only check one thing. So if you're naming like enemies and whatnot, just make sure that there's only one or something. All right. Party cast. Cast to check hero A when in the party, when and not in the party. Include in the reserve, you can check to see who's in your party or if they're not in the party. And again, you can even include your reserve. Items, this checks to see if you have an item in possession, how many you have. You can even include your equipped items that are there. Check money possession, kind of the same thing. If you have enough money, if you don't have enough money. item slots up to 999, oh my goodness. I don't know what this is. I know what this is. It checks to see how much you have in your inventory. Checks to see whether you're in battle or not. It's just very simple. Say, hey, are you in battle? If you are, great. Check monster in battle. You can check whether the specified monster is appearing at the specified index in the battle. So you can check if there's a certain monster in the battle, like say like a, I don't know, since I've been playing a lot of Diablo 4, like a treasure goblin. You can, like, target that. You can make conditions for that. You can check the collision state. This is an awesome feature. You can check. With this event, you wouldn't be able to do it with a common event. You would have to make sure you're targeting an event or using it in an event itself. Player. You can do terrain, object, player, and event. I do believe it's only Let's see. So when you're checking this event, and you need to grab the name or player, and you can only do terrain or event. Yeah. So you can only grab the event name when it's you're checking the event, which you really need if you're checking collision and whatnot. This is a great way to do it. Raycast is fantastic too. We actually recently got the feature now that we can actually see that red line. You can check the source is player or this event referring to a targeted event or an event in the database or the event on the map. The target you checked is terrains, objects, players, events, local and world. I can't remember the difference. I'm sorry, it's out of my head. Front is in front of you, left is the left of you, right, up, down, behind, and you can specify an angle. You can use variables, so you can actually use variables to make like a rotating raycast around you. You can click the amount you want to have it check ahead. Raycasts are phenomenal. Control, this is how you wait time. You can use a variable as well, so like if you want to use delta time, you should use variable for that as well as value. Starting loop, this is a automatic while loop, so if you need to have a while loop, this is how you would do it. And if you need, whenever you need to escape the loop, you escape from loop right there. You can end the event. Excuse me, this stops the event altogether. Executing a common event, this is kind of like a script call in a way. Generating events, this is how we make shooters. You would use an event that you want to shoot, and you'll have your own conditions and everything. I won't go over all that because it would take me way too long. Player, you can use the shooting source as the event or the player. You would pretty much always want to use direction when generating sources face to, and you want to set that to 180 because it'll be exactly right on the player or the right angle. You can shoot from 1 to 50 events at a time. You can change the angle per generation. You can make a random angle per generation, 0 to 360, and you can have a wait time per generation. You can also wait until the shooting is complete to continue through the event. Delete event, this is pretty self-explanatory. Deletes your event. Exit game, you exit the game. You can return to the title screen or game over. Battles. All right, so execute battle and check results. This is kind of like the are they both in conditional judgment? They are. Okay, so you have the same thing from conditional judgment as well. Yes. I don't know why you would use that. Status window on and off. This turns the status window on or off. You can only do this on a battle screen. This reduces and recovers the battle cast HP MP. This is for like using an item or whatnot. You would have a common event that controls all this. That's only for like battle. Battle cast is operation target. This is the exact same thing as the doing an event. This is how you would check or force someone to be a target and whatnot. You can be a cast, party member, or a monster. You can specify their action, so you can literally make an entire battle system just like this. You don't even have to have the options. You can make it you can literally have complete control over the battle system. It's nuts. You would use all this to have your specified battle cast actions. You would use the cast. You can use the party. You can use the instant the monsters in battle. You can have them do attack, guard, charge, do nothing, their own skill. And then target, you can make it random. Cast, blah, 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 all that. I don't know why I say blah, blah, blah. Cast, instant the party, and instant monsters. Now, mind you, this is only for battles. You can't use this outside of the battles. Very self-explanatory. Make your battle state just like this. You can change the state, add a state. Terminate battle forcibly. This is to end a battle very quickly. Yeah, I didn't think there was any options. To stop the battles altogether. This makes a monster appear. Oh, this is placement. So this is monster in the chamber. I don't understand that. All right, so I'm not 100% what that is. So, and I don't use it. So, sorry. Get battle information. This is great for if you want to check the status of a party member or an event or a monster. You can also get the last skill they used. You can store that all into a variable, and you can check that. You can actually check that outside of battle, which is actually really good. You can check whether you're in a battle. This is no configurations. Check monsters in battles. You can check to see who's in battle and whatnot. You can change the battle speed. This is brand new, so you can change the battle speed from 1, I think, to 1,000. Let me see. Yeah. Okay. So 1 to 1,000. Others. Nope. Yeah. This is how you set up notes. So there, it won't show up in your game at all. This is just for you. Hopefully one day they will change the color so it kind of sticks out more. Even with the panel, it doesn't really look that well. So, yeah, that is the event battle or the event battles, the event panels. I didn't 100% go over, like, everything you can do. I just hope that kind of helps you. It explains a little bit about what everything does. And my throat is killing me now, so I'm going to get off of here.